You're welcome.
Yes, thank you for having me.
Not too young to run.
Not at all.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, a symbol of that, not too young to run. Yeah, I know you're an MIT graduate.
Yeah.
You could have done so many other things.
Yeah.
Why politics?
Because I feel that we complain too much. You know, my generation, we talk too much. And there are problems that are only going to get worse the more we leave them to fester. And rather than just talking about it, we should start taking action and doing things about it.
Yeah, our destiny, our future is in our own hands.
Very, very important to you.
You either act today or you stop complaining.
Exactly.
If you can't act, then don't complain.
Exactly.
I agree with you completely on that one. All right. You're not a woman, so to announce your age is not a problem. No. You're 34 years old. Is that your real age?
Yes, my real age.
Yeah, that's the real age.
83.
Okay. All right, so, I mean, that means we have people who are already practicing this not too young to wrong thing.
Yes.
Now, do you think young people in Nigeria are adequately prepared to go into politics? Has this society prepared them enough?
The general nature of our society has not. But there are still a lot of exceptional young people that, if given the chance, they would excel in politics. But the general education system, the society, the moral fiber of society as well, the reality of people's environment does not prepare leaders. It prepares people that can thrive in challenging situations. That does not necessarily mean that they are capable leaders. I mean, I'm sure you're familiar with all these ritualist dens that they've been discovering all over Lagos.
Yeah.
People are trying to thrive in the midst of poverty and bad governance.
Yeah.
So the environment, in my opinion, does not create leaders. But there are a lot of exceptional young people that, if given the chance, they will do quite well.
Yeah, because I was going to ask, you know, this same environment produced you. So based on your explanation, I'll just take it that you're exceptional. You're one of those exceptional
few. You said it.
Okay. All right. So let's move forward. Sometime in 2011, I also had the opportunity to, you know, not just complain, but try as well. I ran for House of Assembly in Imo State, and experiences were gathered.
Yeah.
One of the, let me say, absurd experiences that I had was a situation where some people came to me to say, look, this is not child's play. This is not comedy. Politics is serious.
Yes.
And if you're going to run, you need to prepare yourself spiritually
or
metaphysically. There are places we can take you to.
Yes, of course.
To go and fortify yourself. Yes. Otherwise, they will waste you. You're a young man.
Yes.
Did you have any kind of embarrassing or situations like that where you say, wow,
like
is this what this politics is about?
Situation like that, generally, you meet certain people and they ask you, what kind of backing do you have?
Yeah.
What kind of backing do you have? And
now,
it means
now, by backing, are they?
Spiritual backing. Yes. What kind of spiritual backing do you have?
Yeah.
And at that point, you have to answer whatever your spiritual backing is, you answer. But in terms of embarrassing...
In my own case, it was God, though.
Yes.
God Almighty. I don't know what spiritual...
My own was God.
God Almighty.
My own is God.
Okay.
Is God.
Okay.
But in terms of embarrassing moments, I think when I think to it, like on election day, having spoken to a lot of people and they were passionate about voting for us, and they came to our agents and gave them first right of refusal. Like, listen, we want to vote for you, but we're in the share. You know, it's us. We want to vote for you. See our voters card, but waiting in the share. And we said, we are not buying votes. So he said, okay, if it's like that, now we'll go away. So it literally turned to a voters market. So I think that was embarrassing in the sense of what our voting demographic is. It's an embarrassment I felt for them, you know? And yeah, I think that was...
Okay, it's sad. It's sad that
it's
people...
Sad.
People come to the booths to vote and they are hawking their votes.
Basically.
You know, despite all that we have gone through in this country.
Yes, exactly.
The one opportunity that you have to bring about change, you want to sell your vote at the polling booth. It's sad.
Yes.
People say if you don't vote for the two ruling parties, PDP or APC, that you have wasted your vote.
Mm.
You ran under COA.
I ran under COA.
Do you agree with that assertion?
I don't agree. I mean, a vote is never wasted. A vote can encourage people to run again. A vote can show that, you know, this work that this person did, it yielded some form of results. We had almost 700 people come out to vote for us without paying one naira for anything. And if you understand that, that means 700 people actually ran at the opportunity cost of getting 2,000 naira, in some cases up to 5,000 naira for a vote. So, in my own opinion, a vote is never wasted. In staying at home and not voting, you are wasting your vote. But the point is, a vote actually encourages people to come out, encourages younger people to come out, encourages people to look at other political parties. Because the situation that we have in Nigeria today, nobody can look at it and say we are where we're supposed to be. And it's been run by the same political parties over a period of time since 1960. It's the same machineries that have been renamed and relabeled. So the question is this: participate in politics. It's not just about voting on that day. It's not just about running for elections. It's about asking questions, refusing to sell your vote. It's also about joining political parties so you can have a say. And also even supporting people.
Now, let me ask you, you saw the two leading parties.
Yes.
Which presents a better platform for you to win?
Yes.
APC, PDP.
Yes.
You chose COA.
Yes.
Okay. How did that decision come about? And what were your experiences running for chairmanship in Ikeja local government?
Yes. I felt that I had to make a statement. And the statement was one that was supposed to say, there is another way. And even if we don't win this time, we should start thinking about actively getting involved in politics. And let us see if by talking to people, educating people, interacting with people, they will be able to come on board and let's see what will happen. So that was what it was about. Also, in terms of the experience, it was like baptism on fire because we literally created the entire structure in 3 months.
Where there was none.
There was none.
Yeah.
That's a lot of work.
And a lot of money, maybe.
A lot of money as well. Yeah. Money, yeah. My bank account is not
Right. I've been there before. I know how it is.
So, so we were able to build that in 3 months. And then also, it gives you an insight into actual political machinery. You know, if you just go into a party that's established, you don't really appreciate the subtleties of what makes a machinery work. So, for instance, just trying to organize how to get plates of food to each of your agents on election day.
On election day.
In different places.
That's a logistical challenge.
Logistics.
Considering that there's restriction of movement on that day.
Exactly.
How do you make sure that...
Working all of that...
At least they're working and they're getting some refreshment.
Exactly. Because if another party comes to give them...
Refreshment. They can switch loyalty.
It has gone. Yeah, it has gone.
I know what you're talking about.
And also getting the structure of your canvassers, your agents, because unlike other parts of the world, you have to protect your votes. It's not enough to get people to come out, you must protect your votes because people are actively trying to steal your votes. So all of that gave a lot of practical insight and knowledge. So I will not do it any other way. I've learned so much that I would never have learned if I'd not run.
I agree with you. That same thing I will say to you.
Yeah.
All right, Gbadebo, you've been there, you've done that.
Mm.
I admire your courage as a young man too.
Thank you very much.
You have too many other things to do and you decided, look, let's give this thing a shot. We can't just all sit, watch premiership, watch television soap opera and complain about government. Let us do something.
Mm-hmm.
You have tried, you've been there. What next for Gbadebo?
By God's grace, I'm going to run in 2019. For what, I'm not sure. But prior to that, I want to work on tackling voter apathy. Because it's very important that people participate in politics. You cannot leave election day to the people that just look at their PVC cards as ATMs that yield every 4 years. People that make those kind of decisions can never move the country forward. And a politician that has to spend that kind of money to win an election will never do anything for these people. Because he has to recoup his investment. And two, if he knows that in 4 years time he has to share money again and he will get what he wants, then there's no motivation to even deliver, especially at the local government level. And what is also very important at a local government level is that it's the most vulnerable people that feel the effects of when the government is not working. So for me, fighting voter apathy, voter education, tackling the working class. Working class is not necessarily elite. It's people that believe in dignity of labor. They get up every morning and they go out to work. If those people, if you can convince them to get involved, they will show up and they will not be bought. So tackling that and doing the next one.
Thank you very much, Gbadebo. Simply put, if you're a young person and you're listening, if you're a young person and you're watching, our mumu don't do.
I swear.
Young people. Like Charlie would say, our mumu don't do. You have to get up and be counted.
Yes.
It's been nice talking to you.
Same here.
Keep up the good job.